أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيبي إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين. قال الله تعالى في محكم كتابه الكريم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألم تر كيف ضرب الله مثلا كلمة طيبة كشجرة طيبة أصلها ثابت وفرعها في السماء تؤتي أكلها كل حين بإذن ربها ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس لعلهم يتذكرون آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم اللهم صل على One of the very beautiful and fascinating creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the sun. The sun has many benefits for us as humans and for existence. One of the major and apparent benefits of the sun is that it serves as a source of light. This is one of the benefits in this creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if we look at the sun, and I'm sure most of us, maybe all of us, throughout our educational career, somewhere in there, we remember learning about the sun and some aspects of the sun. And when we go and we examine this creation, we'll notice that it's truly fascinating. For example, one of the fascinating features of the sun is its sheer size. The sun is estimated to be 109 times the size of the Earth in diameter. And if we were to fill up the sun with Earths, planet Earths, it would take about 1.3 million planets the size of Earth in order to fill the sun. Gigantic. It's enormous. When it comes to the mass of the sun, scientists tell us that 99.8% of the mass in the solar system, in our entire solar system, comes from the sun. 99.8. So only 0.2% of the mass comes from everything else in the solar system. When we look at the temperature of the sun, scientists tell us that in the core of the sun, the temperature is approximately 27 million degrees Fahrenheit. That's a huge number. That's something that's very difficult for us to perhaps even fathom and understand. Scientists tell us that the age of the sun right now is about 4.6 billion years, and that the hydrogen, which fuels the sun, it's made up of about 70 to 75% hydrogen, that the sun has already used half of its fuel, the hydrogen, and that it has enough for another 5 billion more years. So it's in its midlife now, and if it goes, if it continues developing as it is now, that it has another approximately 5 billion years of life. The energy produced by the sun, if we wanted to establish this energy or create the energy, the equivalent size or amount of energy that the sun creates, we would have to detonate 100 billion tons of dynamite per second in order to create the equivalent amount of energy that the sun creates. And there are many other benefits. Light is a great benefit. Other benefit is the heat that the sun produces. without this heat, that we would not be able to exist, as life does not exist on other planets that are perhaps further away from the sun than we are. And of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has situated the earth in a way where it's not too close and it's not too far. Because if the earth were to go closer to the sun, there would be problems for us, for life as we know. And this is evident in planets such as Mars. Although scientists have suggested that Mars, there could be life on Mars, signs of life on Mars. But nowadays, and I think it was either today or yesterday, I read a report that the rover that was sent to Mars seems to come out with a more pessimistic conclusion. The possibility of life on Mars seems dimmer now than before because of evidence, scientific evidence. And so heat is another source of blessings that we benefit from the sun. The sun also gives some of us that beautiful tan that we have, right? Without the sun, many people would not enjoy that tan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created this fascinating creation, the sun, and it is there for us to benefit from. But primarily, it is a source of light. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, Allah says, اللَّهُ الَّذِي رَفَعَ السَّمَاوَاتِ بِغَيْرِ عَمَدٍ تَرَوْنَهَا. It is God who has erected the heavens and the skies without pillars. This building, if it weren't for the pillars in this building or the walls of this building, the ceiling would not stand erect. It would fall. It would collapse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here gives us a beautiful illustration. He says, you see these skies and heavens around you? They have been put in place without pillars. It's done through the power of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so precisely and so beautifully that these skies, the way that the earth is produced, the way that the earth is created, and the way that the skies and the universe is created is illustrated to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. بِغَيْرِ عَمَدٍ تَرَوْنَهَا ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى عَلَى الْعَرْشِ وَسَخَّرَ الشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala subjugated for your use, O mankind, the sun and the moon. كُلُّ يَجْرِي لِأَجَلٍ مُسَمَّى. Each goes in its own course for a specific amount of time. Scientists tell us that the sun has the capacity for another 5 billion years, but it's only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who's aware exactly how long the sun will continue on its course, how long this universe continues on its course. This is one blessing. There is another immense blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, a source of light, but not physical light. A source of intellectual, moral, and spiritual light that Allah has bestowed upon us as human beings, as Muslims, and specifically as the followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, and that is the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, and the Ahlul Bayt, the Imams of the Ahlul Bayt, who serve as moral guides, who serve as moral sources of light and illumination upon our hearts and upon our minds. And one of the front runners of this group is our 8th Imam, Al-Imam Ali al-Ridha alayhi salam, who we, during these days, we commemorate the auspicious birth, anniversary of the birth of this holy Imam. Al-Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam was born on the 11th of Dhul Qa'dah, which is the 11th month of the lunar calendar, and in the year 148 after Hijrah. And he experienced, for many years of his life, he experienced the difficulties and the challenges that his father, Al-Imam Musa Al-Kadhim alayhi salam, experienced. And we know that Imam Musa al-Kadhim, he experienced a lot of persecution. He was jailed, he was arrested, and he spent many years in the prisons and in the dungeons of the rulers, the Abbasi rulers at the time, specifically Harun in Baghdad, until he was poisoned, he was killed in Baghdad, and he is currently buried in the area known as Kadhimiyya or Kadhimain in Baghdad. And this was in the year 183 after Hijrah. And so, during this time, during the time of Harun, although the Imams, Al-Imam Musa al-Kadhim alayhi salam, although he was being persecuted, historians tell us that the number of the followers of Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them, it was secretly increasing during this time. And of course, this has much to do with the foundations that were laid down by the fifth and the sixth Imams, Al-Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam and Al-Imam Al-Sadiq alayhi salam, who laid the foundations for Shia theology and jurisprudence and intellectual thoughts. And it continued. And so the number of Shias were gaining during the time of the seventh and eighth Imams secretly, during the times of Harun al-Abbasi, the Caliph. Harun al-Abbasi, in the year 193, 10 years after the martyrdom of Al-Imam al-Kadhim alayhi salam, he died also. And we know that the capital of the time there, the capital was what? Was Baghdad. The capital of the Abbasi regime, the Abbasid dynasty, was Baghdad. And so, after the death of Harun, there was political upheaval in the Muslim community. How? Because two of his sons, on the one hand, Al-Amin, who was in Baghdad, and on the other hand, Al-Ma'mun, who was where? In Khurasan. They had an argument between themselves as to who would be the next what? Khalifa. Who would be the next ruler. And this caused a lot of turmoil, political turmoil in the region and amongst the Muslims. And there were many uprisings, small uprisings. In the end, it was apparent that Al-Ma'mun was militarily superior to his brother, Al-Amin. And so in the end, after 4 years, Al-Amin was killed, and Al-Ma'mun, he took the throngs of the Islamic or the Muslim Empire, the leadership of the Muslim Empire. And he considered himself the new caliph and the new ruler of the Muslims. And so during his time, Al-Ma'mun, he realized that the followers of Ahlul Bayt had increased in their numbers. Because Al-Imam Al-Ridha alayhi salam, during this time, he was still in the city of Medina. Al-Imam Al-Ridha is born in the city of Medina. His father was taken to Baghdad, where he was killed there. But Al-Imam Al-Ridha alayhi salam, he was in the city of Medina. And this, of course, was the city of their grandfather. And so their ties were already historically established there, the ties of the Ahlul Bayt. And so their leadership, the strength of the Ahlul Bayt, began to increase slowly but surely. And Al-Ma'mun, he realized this. And so in order to counter this, he felt that his government would be threatened by the support that the Ahlul Bayt had. He felt that he would be threatened. So he decided to do what? He decided to summon Al-Imam Al-Ridha alayhi salam from Medina to where? To Khurasan. A journey of about 2,000 miles. And he told the Imam, and he did this for two reasons. The first reason was that he wanted to keep an eye on the Imam. He wanted the Imam to be present where he is, so that he can keep an eye on him, so that he is not able to engage in political activity and perhaps overthrow Al-Ma'mun and take over. This is number one. And number two, in order to do what? in order to gain legitimacy. Because during that time, although the Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them, they were oppressed and they were repressed by the government and by other factions, but they still had credibility. The Imams still had popular support. And again, this goes back to the time of the fifth and the sixth Imams. They still had support. And so in order to gain credibility for his authority as the new caliph, as the new ruler, he wanted to bring in Al-Imam al-Rida alayhi salam, and he offered him the what? He offered him Wilayat al-Ahd. Basically that he would be the heir to Al-Ma'mun, that he, Al-Imam al-Rida, would be the next caliph, the next ruler of the Muslims. And now here historians, they have differed. And you see different writings about this case and what happened. Historians, they come and they say that Al-Imam al-Rida alayhi salam, he was given this opportunity by Al-Ma'mun. This expresses how Al-Ma'mun al-Abbasi, he was good with the Ahlul Bayt, that he favored the Ahlul Bayt, because in fact he gave them the opportunity, he promised that the eighth Imam, Al-Imam al-Rida alayhi salam, would become the Khalifa after him. And they begin to speak about these issues, when in reality, historically, we find that this was not the case. In fact, if we read the books of history, we'll notice that accurate references tell us that the Imam was forced to accept this wilayah. He was forced to. Because Al-Ma'mun, in the beginning, Al-Imam al-Rida alayhi salam, he refused. He said, I don't want. Yes, I'll come. I'm summoned to come to Khurasan. I'm forced to come to Khurasan. I'll come. But I don't want to be the heir apparent. I don't want anything to have to do with the political leadership of the Muslims. This is not what I'm looking for. But he was in fact put under pressure until he accepted. And there are many details. He was put under pressure to the point where in the end he agreed. However, he said under one condition. You do not expect from me to command anything, to prohibit anything, to hire someone, bring someone, to fire someone, to change the laws, to enact laws, to bring to become a judge between people in their disputes. I want none of that. As a name, symbolically, okay. But I do not want to be given any authority. Because, and this expresses, this shows us clearly that the Imam alayhi salam was not interested in authority. Because if he was interested in authority, he would have gladly taken the position. And then he would be able to do as he pleases, to bring whoever he wants, to take out whoever he wants. But he did not do so. And so the Imam alayhi salam, he embarked on this journey from Medina to Khurasan, passing through present-day Saudi Arabia, through Iraq, through Iran, to the northeastern province, which during that time, which present-day Khurasan also encompassed, or Khurasan back then encompassed part of present-day Turkmenistan and that region. And so the Imam embarked on this journey of 2,000 miles, and he stopped in many different places on the way. One of the areas that the Imam stopped in is well known, is the area of Nishapur. And there, the Imam had a great following, a lot of support in that area. Historians, they tell us that when the Imam, he arrived there, some of his companions, some of his followers there, they insisted on him to teach them something. Historians, they tell us that the Imam, he was getting ready to leave. He had embarked on his camel, getting ready to leave, where his followers, they stopped. They did not allow the caravan to move. And they began to plead with him. They told him, Ya Ibn Rasulillah, we want you to teach us one thing. We want you to tell us one thing. Relate for us one hadith, something that comes from your grandfather Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala. And so the Imam, the hadith says that the Imam, he lifted, there was a veil on the caravan that he was sitting. He lifted it and he turned to them and he told them, I heard the narration, my father Al-Imam Musa Al-Kadhim narrates this narration from his father Al-Imam Al-Sadiq alayhi salam, from his father Al-Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam, from his father Ali ibn al-Husayn alayhi salam, from his father Al-Imam al-Husayn al-Shaheed alayhi salam, from his father Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, from the Holy Prophet peace be upon him, from Jibra'il, and Jibra'il narrates this hadith from Allah, hadith Qudsi, where he says, Kalimatu la ilaha illallah asni. The testimony of la ilaha illallah, that there is no God but one God, but Allah, Hisni, is my fort, is the fort of God, is God's fort. فَمَنْ قَالَهَا فَقَدْ دَخِلَ فِي حِصْنِي. And whoever proclaims it has entered into God's fort. And whoever enters into God's fort, أَمِنَ مِنْ عَذَابِي. He has been protected from the punishment and the chastisement of God. The hadith says that the people, they began an uproar. The people, they began to repeat, they began to say La ilaha illallah all together. They began to say La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah. The hadith says that the Imam, he started his movement on his camel, and then once again after a few steps he stopped. He once again lifted his veil and he said, بِشَرْطِهَا وَشُرُوطِهَا. However, there is one qualifier, there is one condition. The testimony of that there is no God, but one God is the fortress of God. But there is one condition, there is one qualifier. وَأَنَا مِنْ شُرُوطِهَا. I am that qualifier. The Imam says, I am that condition. The condition is that you realize not his personal, just his personal status as the Imam, but the concept of Imama, the concept of the succession to the Holy Prophet peace be upon him through the Imams. To realize, not just to be able to point the finger and say, this is my Imam and I know his name is Ali ibn Musa al-Ridha and he is my Imam. Not just that, because anyone can do that. But to realize the station of Imamah, to realize what Imamah signifies, this is what the Imam is referring to. And this hadith is very well known. It's known as hadith as-silsila al-dhahabiyya, the hadith, the narration of the golden chain. Why? Because every one of the members, the narrators, was an infallible, and it was originated from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through Angel Jibra'il, through the Prophet, through Amir al-Mu'mineen, all the way down to the 8th Imam, Al-Imam Ali ibn Musa al-Ridha alayhi salam, sallu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. And so this hadith clearly tells us that in order for us as Muslims, in order for us to be safeguarded and protected from the chastisement, from the punishment of God, it's important for us that first that we proclaim our understanding of monotheism, our belief in one God and only one God, but at the same time to implement the teachings of this religion that is given to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all aspects of our life. And this is the essence of recognizing the station and the status of Imam. Because the job of the Imams was to do what? The job of the Imams was to maintain this tradition, was to maintain the message of the Holy Prophet peace be upon him. And so to realize and accept the Imam means that I'm following in his footsteps, that I'm also maintaining this religion in every aspect of my life. Personally, on a personal note, whenever I come across a birthday of one of the infallibles, either the Prophet or Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam, or any one of the Imams, for me, it's a time of re-evaluation. Of course, it's a time of celebration. It's a time where we congratulate one another. It's a time where it's festive, it's happy for us. For those who are privileged and honored to be in the holy shrines during these times, they see how beautiful the environment is. But for me, it's a time of examination. It's a time of evaluation and re-evaluation of myself. When I think of the Imam and his birth and his birthday, and I ask myself, what does this mean to me? What does it mean that I am celebrating the birth of Al-Imam Al-Ridha alayhi salam? Is this just the tradition that I have been taught since I was young maybe? Is this all, or is there essence to my celebration of the birthday of the Imam? Do I, as one who claims to be the follower of this Imam, do I truly represent the Imam in all aspects of my life? If I were to be standing in that crowd hearing the Imam say بِشَرْطِهَا وَشُرُوطِهَا وَأَنَا مِن شُرُوطِهَا, would I understand and fully realize the meaning of these powerful words? Do I implement the teachings? Do I represent the Imam? Do I at least try to adhere to a lifestyle that the Imam promoted and encouraged? When it comes to the life of the Imam, I don't know where to start, truly. When we examine the life of the Imams in general, we really don't know where to start. What aspect of their life do we look and do we try to emulate? Was it the way that Al-Imam Al-Ridha alayhi salam used to respect others? How he used to respect those around him? The hadith by our ninth Imam, the son of Al-Imam Al-Ridha, Al-Imam Muhammad Al-Jawad, he was asked one day, why was your father called Al-Ridha? Al-Ridha means what? It means satisfaction, contentment. Why specifically, out of all of the Imams, was your father named Al-Ridha? After all, technically, all of them are Al-Ridha. The Imam, he beautifully replied. He said that my father was called Al-Ridha because both his friends and his foes were pleased with him. And this never happened with any other Imam. Look at the history of the Imams. The Imams, they had friends and foes. All of them. They had their loyal companions and they had their enemies. But not all of them were loved and pleased or their enemies were satisfied and pleased with. Whereas Al-Imam Al-Ridha was different. Al-Imam Al-Ridha, even his enemies, they were pleased with him. Even his enemies, they were satisfied with him. Of course, this does not mean that the Imam was made himself humble to them in the sense where he expressed or he were to water down his faith or his religion or to make compromises to his enemies. Absolutely not. But in his dealing, he would be respectful. He would express respect to his foes, to his enemies, to the point where they could not help but also respect him back. Where they could not help but be satisfied with his morals, with his akhlaq. And the Imam, he teaches us this great lesson. He teaches us that even those who are your enemies, those who are considered your enemies, that there has to be a level of respect. There has to be a level of respect. Again, this doesn't mean that we compromise our values, we compromise our teachings. Absolutely not. But in our dealings with others, we have to respect one another. This is what the Imam teaches us. Not only our enemies, but our friends and our family members also. Because sometimes, some people, the issue that they have is that they're great with enemies in the public sphere, with their enemies, with strangers. They're great, they're very respectful. But when they come home, it's as if he or she is a different person. They've changed 180 degrees. With strangers, they're good. With their family members, with their parents, with their children, with their husband or wife, they turn into what? They turn into the devil in their teachings. There's no respect. There's no tolerance. There's no engagement. The Imam teaches us to respect each and every person, those who are our enemies and those who are our friends. The hadith, they tell us that the Imam on this journey, this long journey, time and time again, and he had a group of people, an entourage with him. Some of them were his servants, people who would serve him. That when it would come time to eat, the Imam, he would bring everyone together to eat together. And sometimes when they were not eating together, when he would need something and he would call out for some of his servants or helpers to help him, when he was told that they are eating, he would say, let them finish eating, and then let them finish eating. He would respect those around him to the point where even those who were considered weak, who didn't have authority, the Imam would respect them. The Imam's dealings read about how he dealt with the issue of racism. If you read about racism, right, especially here in the United States, you'll know that, alhamdulillah, our history is filled with racism, unfortunately. It's filled with instances of racism, with prejudice, with bias, against religious groups, against, you know, colors and backgrounds and ethnicities, and even till this day. Sometimes it's not open, it's not clear, it's not manifest, but discreetly, it's still there. And you'll notice that when we read about racism and civil rights, what comes up? The issue of the civil rights movement in the 50s and mainly in the 60s, individuals such as MLK, other individuals who were proponents of civil rights, their names are brought forth, right? And this was only what? This was only 50 years ago. Just a few weeks ago, a couple of weeks ago, was the 50-year anniversary of the march, right? So for the past 50 years, the United States, the most advanced country in the world, and the leader of the free world, did what? Started to address the issue of civil rights, of racism, of combating racism. When you go back to the time of Al-Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam and notice how he practically combated racism. Because sometimes you can say, yes, as human beings we're all created equal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, God has created us all equal. Arab, non-Arab, white, black, brown, yellow, we're all equal. Theoretically this sounds great and lots of people, they suggest. But practically, Islam combated racism. Practically. The instance that I just mentioned, the example when the Imam would sit, some of those who would help him, some of those who were his companions, those who were around him, they were not Arabs. They were either non-Arabs, they were black, they were African, they were from different parts. Some of them, when they would sit, other companions, they would complain, they would sit, say, why are we all sitting together? This person's black, this person's, you know, Persian, this person's so-and-so. And the Imam, he would excuse all of these excuses. He would dismiss these excuses. And he would practically sit with those around him to show that Islam is colorblind. This is something that we have to learn, brothers and sisters. It's a problem. And I say this when we talk about racism, unfortunately, the thing that comes to mind is that it's the people who are out there. They're the ones who are expressing racism. They're the ones who are expressing nationalism. They're the ones who are prejudice and bias. But even in our own communities, even in our own communities, we notice that unfortunately sometimes there are instances of racism. There are instances of hate, of prejudice, of bias against others. This person is not from my country. This person is Iranian. This person is Iraqi. This person is Arab. This person is non-Arab. this person's black, this person's Afghani, this person's Pakistani, and so on and so forth. And we find it. It happens with gatherings, it happens sometimes at Islamic centers, and this is unfortunate. This is unfortunate. Because this is not what we have been taught by our leaders. This is not what we have been taught by our religion and those who represent our religion. When it comes to the way that we give, do we give generously? Alhamdulillah, some of us we give. But do we give generously? And what I mean by generously is not necessarily a quantitative measure. Not necessarily something great, a large amount. Generosity means that you do so from what? Out of love. This is what generosity really is. And this is what Allah tells us. لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ Real righteousness and real generosity is when you give out of that which you love. When we give, do we give out of what we love? Unfortunately, sometimes we notice that when we give, there's a qualifier, there's a condition also. Right? It could be on a personal level. You give someone some financial assistance, and there's a condition, right? It's not for free, it's not for the sake of God. I don't want to give specific examples. We all know what we're talking about. Sometimes some individuals, they want to give to an organization or a cause, but it also has a condition. Under the condition that you put my name as one of the sponsors. Under the condition that you put my name on the wall of, you know, you put a plaque and so on and so forth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, He says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُبْطِلُوا صَدَقَاتِكُمْ بِالْمَنِّ وَالْأَذَى O you who believe, do not void, do not nullify your charity by doing what? By hurting the other person. By expressing that you have favored this person by allowing them. This is something that I noticed maybe 2 days ago. I was dropping my son off at school in the morning. I exited the freeway. And we were on the traffic light. And there was a poor person standing on the side, begging on the side. And so I looked in the rear view mirror. I saw him walking quickly. I looked in the rear view mirror. And I noticed that someone had their hand out. They had rolled down the window. They had their hand out. The man was walking towards the car. Suddenly I saw him. He knelt down. I looked and I noticed that the man was picking up the money from the ground, from the ground next to the car. And I asked my son, I didn't notice. And my son told me, he said, Baba, the man just threw the dollar on the ground. Now, I don't know if he did it on purpose, if it fell from his hand. But in the end, sometimes, and this is an example, but sometimes the charity that we give is more harmful than if we don't give at all. Amir al-Mu'mineen, he has a beautiful saying. He says, give even if it's a little amount, because giving a little amount is better than not giving at all. But sometimes, the way that we give is worse than if we were not to give at all. Because when you don't give at all, you're not giving anything, but you're not taking anything. When you give and you degrade the person, not only are you not really giving them anything, but you're taking something away from them. You're taking their honor, you're taking respect away from them. And so it becomes even worse. Al-Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam, in a famous story, a man, he comes to him during the time of Hajj. The man is well off. He comes to the Imam. He says, I'm a traveler. I have come here to perform the Hajj. And I have lost my money. And it happens, right? Unforeseen circumstances. He told him, back home, I'm well off. I'm not in need of charity. I'm in need of assistance just for me to go back home. The Imam, he enters into his home. He brings a bag of money. And the hadith says that the Imam, he's hiding behind the door. He puts his hand out and he says, come and take the money. The man, he comes, he takes the money. And he tells him, if you can, I would appreciate it if you would leave in a way that I don't see you and you don't see me. And the man left. When the Imam came out, one of his companions, he was sitting. He told him, Yabna Rasulullah, you helped this man out. But why did you hide behind the door? He told him, because I did not want to humiliate this man by allowing him for me to see his face as he received this money. I tried to do so in a way that was not humiliating to him. I didn't want to see his face or for him to see my face during this. I did not want to break his heart or make him feel disrespected. This is the Imam. This is an Imam Ali ibn al-Ridha alayhi salam. Brothers and sisters, these acts, seemingly they seem very simple. They seem very simple. But it is these acts and similar acts that build our character. It is these acts that build who we are as followers of the Ahlul Bayt. Because, and I've said this before, lots of people, they can pray, lots of people can fast. On the day of Ashura, Imam Hussein prayed and Umar ibn Sa'ad prayed. Imam Hussein prayed with his companion, and Umar ibn Sa'ad, the commander of the enemy army, prayed with his soldiers. 30,000 men, they prayed. But what benefit was their prayer? It's these little things, the things that don't make big headlines, but when it comes to our character, they build our character. These are what allow us to follow in the footsteps of the Imams, to implement their teachings, to become true representatives of the Imams. And so as we celebrate the birth of Al-Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam, let us take some time to think about these. How we can try to emulate our Imams and our leaders. Brothers and sisters, I have a very short poem that I wrote for the anniversary of the birth of Al-Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam, and I'll end with it. The poem is entitled Mashhad, I have a great longing for you. Mashhad, I have a great longing for you. The love I hold deep, if you only knew. Is it because you are my place of birth? Is this the reason I see in you worth? You brought me forth, but that is not it. It is quite clear why in my heart you sit. Alas, you are the home to a shining star. Nay, the sun of suns, Shamsu Shumus, the sun of suns whose light shines so far. The king of Tus, son of God's appointee. Without him which your land would be empty. There was a time he was a stranger here, from his dear family no longer near, but now take a look at what has happened. Waves of lovers before unimagined. They flock to their master, each one with needs. This one prays intensely and that one pleads. O Abu al-Hasan, to you I have come. Mawla, to your kindness I will succumb. Not even once, you've never let me down. Me with your favors, you proceed to drown. Master al-Ridha, you I really miss. Once more, please allow me your shrine to kiss. Once more, allow me to stare at your dome. Perhaps even to call Mashhad my home. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, to grant us all the visitation of Al-Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam in this life, and his shafa'ah and intercession in the hereafter. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give a full and speedy recovery to those who are ill, especially the brothers who are suffering from cancer and other ailments. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless the souls of those who have passed away. وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات نهدي جميعا ثواب سورة الفاتحة مع الصلوات.